This is Andy Daly. Before we get to the matter at hand, i.e. the podcast you're about to listen to, I want to have a word with you about Heineken, which is a beer, which is available wherever you buy your beers. And I believe you can get it in either a can or a bottle, but not in, they don't have it in the like cardboard carton like you get milk. Just FYI, if that's how you like to drink your beer, not an option with Heineken as far as I'm aware. Here comes the copy. With all the stresses of life, it can be easy to lose perspective on what really matters. But Heineken believes that life is about being with friends and opening yourself to new experiences. Because when you live spontaneously and embrace the unexpected, it's a chance to create new stories and connections. You just have to be open to it. What is the it? Living spontaneously or embracing the unexpected or creating new. I'm not sure what the it qualifies. Doesn't matter. Here comes the call to action. Enjoy a refreshingly cold, full-bodied Heineken Lager today. Don't wait till tomorrow. Make a plan to do this today. With its deep golden color, light fruity aroma, mild bitter taste, and a crisp, clean finish. You'll know you're finished when it's crisp and clean. Cheers! This episode of the Andy Daly Podcast, blah, 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 is also brought to you by PodSwag. PodSwag is your one-stop shop. You just got to stop in the one place for podcast merch and the only place where you can get official Andy Daly podcast swag. Have you checked out the Andy Daly podcast swag that's on Pod Swag? We have Schmeideberg pretzel shirts, Journeyman shirts. I mean, that's good stuff. And it's the only place you can get it. We've got shirts, posters, a bunch of pins are up for sale right now. There are pins for sale. God knows why, of my face and also Matt Gourley's face. You can just pin us on your shirt and take us around with you wherever you go and show us stuff. This is available only on podswag.com. I wonder if anybody owns these. Does anybody own a pin of me? And if so, what are you doing with it? Well, good for you. Go get yourself one. So go to podswag.com/Andy and start your Andy Daly pin collection today. Get one for every outfit, every scarf and every necktie and every hat. That's podswag.com/Andy.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Andy Daly Podcast Pilot Project. Here are your hosts, Matt Gourley and Andy Daly.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Go For It!
The Andy Daly Podcast Pilot Project.
I don't think that's right.
No, it seems wrong.
It seems wrong. I know it's right, but it seems wrong.
Oh, God, you scared me. I still don't have full confidence in this. And we've only got one more episode to get this right, even though that was right.
That was right, and yet it was still wrong somehow.
But I think next time we'll not only get it right, we'll get it right with conviction. And, yeah.
And it's going to feel right.
Yeah, well, speaking of conviction.
Yes.
Criminal conviction.
Yeah. Yes. This is a serious podcast. This episode is a very serious one because it deals with a crime. A crime has been committed. And this intrepid reporter, Alex Higgs Portman, is that her name?
Uh-huh.
A Pasadena journalist has submitted this podcast to us. And she's obviously digging deep into this very serious crime that has been.
Yeah, it's very intriguing because this is a, you know, we'll say it, it's a serial-like podcast that's become a popular format now, an investigatory podcast, a true crime podcast. And it's interesting that she works at this Pasadena publication and they're not releasing it themselves, that she submitted it to us.
It sounds like the publication she works for is very small and maybe not entirely supportive of her efforts.
And maybe they don't get this, the new medium, you know, of podcasting. And they recognize that we're at the cutting edge of this medium and that this would be the home for it.
Exactly. Yes. Yes. So this journalist is definitely, I believe she's setting out to right a wrong. At least I think so, based on what we know from this first episode. And she is doing it in the style of Serial or S-Town or Dirty John. Mm-hmm. It's that kind of a thing. And it's, I feel it's very compelling in the same ways that those are.
Oh, it's gripping. It's intriguing from interview subject to interview subject. I'm on tenterhooks. I can't wait to hear what's next. And the fact that this one you know, could go on for multiple episodes to find out more about this case means it alone should be a reason for green lighting. We need to know what happened.
Absolutely. I completely agree. And so the crime revolves around a guy named Cactus Tony, who, from what I understand, has actually been involved in the Earwolf podcasting unit, which is amazing. And I don't think she even touches on that, but he has been a podcast guest, maybe of Comedy Bang Bang or something.
Yeah, I believe so.
So that's incredible. So that already is like a connection to this world.
Yeah.
And is all the more reason to pick it up to a regular podcast, in my opinion.
And I think, too, because true crime podcasts also involve a sort of interactive element, like they call them citizen sleuths, where they all get on message boards and kind of talk about did he or didn't he do it. Mm-hmm. This should be no different. Go to the Reddit subreddit for Earwolf. Mm-hmm. Start talking about, did he do it? Did he not do it? Do you have information that you can contribute to this case? Talk about it there.
Absolutely. Yes. I think almost anybody would be as qualified to uncover the facts of this case as Alex Higgs Portman is. So get in there. Please tell us what you know. That's a great idea.
And because if you have more information, that will fuel further, you know, episode material. And it could free an innocent man, or it could convict a guilty man, or convict an innocent man, or free a guilty man.
All of which would be worthwhile outcomes from this podcast. So I hope you enjoy it, and I hope you're not too terrified by it. But this, ladies and gentlemen, is The Long Story with Alex Higgs Portman.
This is a prepaid phone call from...
Is that the beep? Drudge, say my name after...
An inmate.
It's Cactus Tony.
At a California corrections facility.
From the Pasadena News Press Times Gazette and the Earwolf Podcast Network, this is The Long Story, a podcast about one thing that takes a bunch of episodes to tell you about because, well, it's kind of a long story. I'm Alex Higgs Portman. I'm a writer for Pasadena, California's local weekly newspaper, the Pasadena News Press Times Gazette. We don't cover the hard stuff. We usually leave violent crimes and scandals to the daily paper, instead focusing on arts, entertainment, and feature stories about our pretty good life in this basically typical small city in America. This story, the one this podcast is about, is pretty different for me, and it came about in a really kind of odd way. Last summer, I wrote a story about people who can test their parking tickets and the surprisingly good chance you have of getting one of those disputes resolved in your favor. I got a lot of feedback from the piece, but there was one letter that really stood out. It was handwritten on stationery from the Pasadena Fairy Tale Theater, a longstanding local institution. The letter was from a man who introduced himself as a theatrical director, and he said he was writing to tell me of a friend of his. A guy who goes by the name of Cactus Tony, who, like the people in my parking ticket piece, had recently been found guilty of a minor infraction. But Don, that's the director's name, didn't think he was guilty. I nearly threw the letter out at that point because, let's face it, it didn't sound all that interesting. But something compelled me to read on. And I'm glad I did, because the more I read, the more Cactus Tony's alleged infraction didn't seem minor at all. In fact, it sounded really, really bad. I decided to call Don to get more information.
Don DiMello, theatrical director. Hello?
Hi, Don. This is Alexandra.
Alexandra? Oh. Is this the Alexandra from our production of Hansel and Gretel? And if so, I have seen the letters from your lawyer, and I'm not paying attention to those.
No, this is Alexandra from the Pasadena News Press Times Gazette. We corresponded over email. About your letter?
Oh, okay. Oh, yes. Hello. From the Pasadena News Times Press Gazette thing. Yes. Good. Oh, this is good. Thank you for calling me. Hello.
Thank you for taking the time to talk to me.
Of course. How are you?
I was very intrigued by your letter.
Ah, yes. And now refresh me, because I wrote two letters to that newspaper. One was a very, very angry complaint about your refusal to ever review one of my productions. And the other had to do with Cactus Tony, a friend of mine. Which letter are you referring?
The letter about your friend Cactus Tony.
Okay, good. Well, that will be a more pleasant conversation, because your newspaper has not even one time sent somebody to review one of my productions. And I think that is a major oversight, and it is infuriating, and I don't understand what that's about. I mean, about 20 years ago, we had somebody in who came, and from what I understand, she joined a convent right after seeing the show. But it's been 20 years, and that person never even wrote up a review. Anyway.
Yeah, I'm happy to address that with my editors.
That'd be nice.
No problem.
Because we're just putting on shows here. We're putting on shows for children, for the whole family. And so it'd be really nice to get some coverage in the Gazette, Times, Press, Gazette, Dispatch.
Okay, great. No, I totally agree. Can we just get back to your letter about Cactus Tony?
Yes. Well, and they're very much related, because Cactus Tony is a huge part of my organization. He is my Guy Friday. He is my right hand. He is my number 2, 3, 4, and 6. Got a different number 5. He does huge things for me. It's very important to the organization, and the organization has been crippled ever since Cactus Tony has been convicted of this very minor crime.
I'm so interested. It sounds like you guys not only work together, but you're pretty close, too.
Yes, Cactus Tony and I are dear, dear friends. I don't know much more about him beyond that his name is Cactus Tony, but I consider him a dear, dear friend, yes.
Do you think we could talk a little bit about the alleged live burial?
Indeed, yes. This is a situation where what he has been convicted of is, I guess, ending somebody's life by way of putting them in a hole and covering them over with dirt. And, you know, I mean, like, big deal. Anyway, the evidence against him was very slight, and I mean, I attended a couple of the days of the trial, and I says, this is going to be fine. I'm not worried about Cactus Tony, and from everything I understand, the evidence against him was just about nothing, and this was like a, you know, it was like a perfunctory thing. Like, we just, you know, we got to have a trial because that's what we do. Everybody thought he was going to be let off. I'm in a state of shock that they found him guilty. They had nothing on Tony. I don't know what happened, and I simply don't understand.
I can tell you're really upset.
Oh, yeah, I'm furious. Because, look, here's what happens. When we do these productions, and we're putting on a beautiful production soon of Disney's Peter Rabbit, at Don DeMello's Disney's Peter Rabbit, and it's going to be great. But, you know, kids have a hard time sitting still for an entire play. And a lot of the time, parents will say, this part of the play I don't want my kid to see. That happens with children's theater all the time. And in our case, when that happens, we have on-site child care. And Cactus Tony is in charge of the on-site child care. And so I am furious that I don't have my guy anymore to take care of that for me. And I'm very angry, and I'm angry on Tony's behalf, because it's wrong that he's in jail.
Don, I want to help you find out what's going on with your friend.
Thank you. Thank you. As I say, I attended a couple of the days of this trial. I was there for two of the days while the prosecution was laying out their case against Tony, and they had nothing. They had photographs, they had, you know, witness testimony, you know, and they had, I don't know, whatever, but they didn't have anything putting him there doing this thing. So how do they convict? How do they convict? I don't know. How do they do it? It doesn't make any sense to me. I gotta figure that this jury was somehow in on some kind of a thing, and they're part of some kind of a conspiracy, and I gotta think it goes all the way to the top of Pasadena City Hall, where these guys, I mean, there's some kind of a cabal in there, and there's some kind of a Freemasons type of situation going on there, because I'll tell you, Pasadena City Hall has had it in for me and my entire organization for a long time, and that's what's going on here. This thing is labyrinthine. It's a miasma. It's a riddle inside of a small box. It is a bad thing, and we gotta get to the bottom of this.
You were kind of cutting out there.
Oh, was I? Why, what happened?
I'm sorry, are you driving through a tunnel?
I am in a tunnel, and I have constructed a series of tunnels to get me to and from the Pasadena Fairy Tale Theater from just about any place in Pasadena, and it's where I conduct most of my business.
Does it go to the San Rafael Hills area? That's where I live.
I'm working on an extension, a tunnel extension to the San Rafael Hills area, but I'm running into a lot of opposition from the water company.
Oh, wow. Okay, moving on. Now, these are really huge allegations.
Yeah, they are. Well, look, I mean, there's no other explanation for this. I mean, you know, what is it called? Occam's razor, where you ask yourself, what's the simplest, logicalist, most simple logical explanation for something? And in this case, it is that there is some kind of a Freemason cabal at Pasadena City Hall that is trying to bring down Don DeMello Productions by taking away my child care guy through an elaborate and complicated murder scheme and bringing him down by way of bringing me down, by way of bringing him down. It is the only explanation, and we just gotta find the proof.
Wow.
Sweetheart, I handed you the story of the year as far as Pasadena is concerned. You are going to win a Pasadena Pulitzer if you crack this thing wide open.
I'm going to try my best. Looks like I got a lot of work ahead of me.
You do. Now let's turn to the topic of sending somebody out here to review Don DeMello's Disney's Peter Rabbit.
I think I can get someone on that for you, Mr. DeMello.
That would be nice. And, you know, listen, it's true that sometimes our productions are at inconvenient hours. We don't always do the show at times that you might expect a children's theater show to be conducted, and that's just, you know, we do things different. But it would be great to get a reviewer out here. I think we'll blow their socks off. You know, I will send over some mimeographs of some of the work of another reviewer, a fellow by the name of Mal Backman, who consistently reviews our productions and always gives them between 5 and 50,000 stars. Sometimes his review is just nothing but 10 pages of stars. And so this guy loves it. And why can't I get the Pasadena Gazette Times Dispatch Picayune over there to check this thing out?
Well, maybe I could come down, see the production, and then we can talk a little bit more about your friend, Cactus Tony.
That would be wonderful. And, you know, I got to get my Cactus Tony back. And I hope that you'll help me.
I'm going to try.
All right, thanks. What'd you say your name was again?
Alexandra Higgs Portman, but you can call me Alex.
Thanks, Alex. I can tell by your voice that you're beautiful.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think you're in that tunnel again. You're kind of cutting out. What did you say?
Nothing. There's just certain things I can tell about a woman by her voice. I like everything I'm hearing.
Oh, thank you. So I should probably hop off now.
Alrighty. Bye-bye.
Bye. I couldn't help but feel bad for Don. Here he was, a very elderly man, close to death, trying to bring live theater to Pasadena's children, and his friend, the guy who helps him out by running his child care facility, suddenly gets swept up in a murder investigation? It didn't seem fair. And I had to agree with Don. Something about it just didn't feel right.
Oh, sure. I mean, if you want to start there, that's as good a place as any, because that's the first time I came into contact with the case.
This is Pasadena Police Detective Gordon Ramsey. He was on the homicide desk the day the murder was called in. The murder Cactus Tony is currently serving life without parole for supposedly committing. Just a warning here, some of what he's about to tell us about this murder is a little disturbing. Detective Gordon Ramsay, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me. I really appreciate it.
Of course, I'm always willing to serve the public.
So, if you don't mind just kind of walking me through the scene of the crime.
We got a report of a disturbing sight of some sort. I drove out. It was an empty lot. Got to the scene. I walked up. I seen a bunch of candles. They weren't lit, but they clearly had been because there was a lot of wax dripping. Drippings.
Is that something you've seen before in your professional experience?
Lit candles?
Uh-huh.
Both professionally and in my personal life.
Where do all those candles go?
Where do they go?
Yeah, are they just stored away or does someone get to take them home?
Nobody gets to take them home. Once something is at a crime scene, it becomes evidence.
Oh, as evidence.
Exhibit A, Exhibit
I'm
B.
I'm currently planning a wedding, and candles are very expensive. I don't know if you realize.
Oh, you don't have to tell me.
I mean, they're like $4 each, even if you're going to IKEA.
I bought a chocolate coffee thing at Bed Bath & Beyond. It cost me $26 for a 9-inch pillar.
It's insane.
I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? I mean, I had a 10% discount card that I got in the mail. You know how Bed Bath & Beyond always sends those discount cards?
Oh, yeah. You're crazy to buy anything there that's not discounted.
Right. Every time I get one, I'm like, I know where I'm going this Saturday.
Me too.
Yeah. So now I'm walking around, and right next to the candles, I seen a slaughtered goat.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, and I checked for a pulse, the heart. First of all, you don't know where to check, really, but I always go neck first, and then, because I don't know where the heart is in the body, you know, of a goat. I don't know where he keeps his heart. So I checked the pulse, and nothing. Also, there was copious amounts of blood around the goat, and it had clearly been sliced open, ear to ass, and the entire insides were spilled out. That's when I seen the heart. After I checked the neck, I seen a heart over behind the tail there, which is probably not where it was supposed to be, but I checked the heart anyway. I you know, two fingers to the heart.
Wow.
And then there's a bunch of footprints, and that indicated to me that there had been a crowd of people there, or someone who kept switching shoes and walking to different spots. So I surveyed the entire scene. This was all close up. I walked a little further away, and I come across a mound of dirt. And that's not something you see every day. You seen a mound of dirt today?
Not today, no.
Anyway, I dig into the dirt, and first thing I find is a leg.
A human leg.
Bingo.
Were you the only person on this job?
Yeah, I work alone.
Okay.
So anyway, I dig, spread, and exposed the body of a male human. First thing I do, I check for a pulse. I check at the heart. Region, which in a human I know where it is. Goat, obviously I don't. Human, I do. Check his heart. Nothing there. So this guy's dead.
Wow.
I noticed that the male had an eye painted on his forehead. At first I thought he was winking at me, but then it was a little cockeyed. Then I realized that he's dead, so he's not winking, but also he has two eyes in the front of his face and one on the top of his forehead, and then I called it in.
Was there any forensic evidence at the crime that would connect this to Cactus Tony?
Cactus Tony? I didn't see any cactus there, so no.
I'm sorry, I don't know a whole lot about being a detective, but...
Yeah, me neither. That's a detective joke.
It's really funny.
Thank you.
But were there any witnesses?
So, here's the thing. You're in an empty lot, basically underneath the 101. What are you going to do? Stop cars on the highway and say, do you come by here every day? Did you happen to see a bunch of people standing around a bunch of candles, killing a goat and burying a guy with an eye on his forehead? Too hard. But I did wander the neighborhood and say, folks, you seen anything? And people take that in a variety of ways because some of them will give you quite a story about what they seen, which don't necessarily have nothing to do with what you're looking for. You know, nobody's given me a lot. At that point, what we like to do is we like to use the newspapers. We go to the newspapers. We find somebody such as yourself, a young reporter that we can exploit and say, hey, how about you put an article in your paper about this and ask if anybody's seen anything? We give them a tip line. All of a sudden, we start getting a lot of messages on the tip line. And a lot of them are tips that have nothing to do with the case. One guy just called and he goes, hey, I got a tip. Look behind you. Uh-huh. That doesn't help. You know, that's just wasted time. That's me listening to a message. Because I start writing down, what time did the call come in? Where did it come from? What part of town? And then I start writing. As soon as he starts talking, I'm trying to transcribe what he says. I'm like, hey, look. And then I realize it's just some fucking asshole.
But
and I wasted
you?
All my time. Of course, I'm always going to follow every tip. I look behind me.
And?
I just seen Fred Schmoller, who sits at the desk right behind me. And I'm like, Fred's got nothing to do with this. I know that going in.
He's got an alibi.
I said, Fred, you're under arrest. I'm kidding. It was a tip that came in about you.
Oh, wow.
But anyway, at some point, I did get a call that led me to believe that this person might know something about what's going on here. So I had to track this guy down. Which was not hard because he did leave his address and phone number on the message. And, you know, I just gone, anybody know where this is? And Fred, you know, sitting right behind me, goes, hey, Google it. He was right. I Googled it, came right up, and I tracked this guy down.
And you're sure he was telling the truth and didn't just want attention?
What you can do is you look him in the eyes, and if they look to the right or to the left, no. If they look back and to the left, they're lying. If they look front and to the right, they're telling... the truth. There's all kinds of psychological tricks you learn when you're a gumshoe like me.
It sounds like it. It's so fascinating.
Yeah, it's an interesting line of work, you know?
Well, thank you so much for all this information.
I hope it comes in handy for whatever this thing is.
It's called a podcast.
Yeah. What station is that on?
It's not. It doesn't air on television. It's on the internet.
Oh, so what time does it come on?
It'll just be out.
What day of the week?
It's out all the time. You know, I can write you a detailed email
just
explaining
tell me, no,
it.
No, it's okay. Just tell me, just write down what time it comes on and what network and then what day of the week and I'll be able to check it out.
Okay, will do. The witness who contacted Detective Ramsey would turn out to be incredibly important to the investigation. And luckily for this podcast, their interview was recorded.
This interview is being conducted by Detective First Grade Gordon Ramsey. It is May 21st, 2017.
I want to play it for you in its entirety, not just because of how well it lays out the state's case against Cactus Tony, but also because it ends up being a fascinating look at how a seasoned detective hones in on the truth.
Would you please state your name, sir?
My name is Hendrix Murphy.
And Mr. Murphy, can you tell me what you do for a living?
I am a shrimp sheller down.
Shrimp? Shrimp what?
Shrimp sheller.
Do you sell shrimp or you shell shrimp?
I shell shrimp.
I'm still not quite sure what you said.
I'm a shrimp sheller, man.
What do you do?
Do you eat shrimp?
Yes.
I shell it.
Okay.
Do you eat it with the shell on?
I do not.
Do you buy it?
Yes, I do.
I shell it.
I'm still, you know what? Let's just move on.
Anyway, down at the bait and tackle, they got a grill in the back.
All right, let's get past the fucking occupation thing, all right?
Hey, you asked me, man.
I know I did, but you're not... Look, this is one of our faults, and it ain't necessarily obvious whose.
Should my lawyer be in here with me now?
No. You're not under suspicion of anything.
All right.
Tell me how old you are, Mr. Murphy.
I am 57 years old.
All right. And where were you born?
In Lake Pontchartrain, Louisiana.
So what made you leave?
The market had just got oversaturated.
With
so...
What?
With shrimp shellers.
God damn it.
And so I felt like I needed to make a change. And
go somewhere else to do what?
Go somewhere else to shell shrimp.
Motherfucker. All right. Doesn't matter.
It's a big business. I can give you, I do seminars on it as well. If you like to attend.
Seminars?
One. Yeah.
You teach people
how to shell shrimp.
Is there anything else you could do that with? What you do, could you do that with other things?
You could shell crabs. You could shell any shellfish, you could shell it.
So it's focused on shellfish in particular.
Look, man, do I need my lawyer to be here with
me? No, you're not under suspicion of a crime, okay? You're just being a good citizen who's good at some things and maybe not so good at other things like articulation. All right. So you left me a message. You might have some information about the body I found out in that vacant lot down by the 101.
Look, all I know is this, okay? I tell you everything I know.
Not everything.
All right.
That would take quite a while, I suspect.
I was working down at the bait and tackle where I worked, and I stepped outside in the back to have me a cigarette.
Not good for you, by the way.
So I've been smoking cigarettes since I was 9 years old.
Mm-hmm.
See, back then, you could buy cigarettes, guns.
What else could you buy?
Nudie magazines, vodka. I didn't drink the vodka. That was for my father.
Sounds like there's a lot of sad stories there.
He enjoyed a drink every now and then. Do you not drink
it? Yeah, but why is he not going himself? Why is he sending his 9-year-old down to buy nudie magazines and vodka?
Because his leg got blown off in Korea.
I'm sorry. That was inappropriate on my part. I apologize and thank him for his service, please.
Thank you. Do I need my lawyer in here?
No, you're not under suspicion of a crime. Let your lawyer sit outside where he is.
He dropped me off.
I know.
He also drives Uber, though, and he kept the meter running, so.
So you're being charged for this?
Yes, I am.
Send me the expense report, and I'll see what I can do about that.
Oh, that's great. I will definitely do that.
All right.
So anyway, I stepped outside the bait and tackle to have a cigarette. Man walks up to me. He says, hey, can I bum one of those off you?
That bother you?
No, I'm a giving man. That's kind of what you do as a shrimp sheller, too. You have to understand and respect people when you're shelling their shrimp.
When you're
shelling their shrimp.
I'm sorry, this is a bit of a detour, but let's say you meet a guy who catches shrimp.
Yeah, I take it off his hands, I take care of it.
And how do you take care of it?
By shelling it.
Son. All right, so what struck you about this whole thing? This guy bums your last cigarette.
He bums my last cigarette. So we stand there and we talk for a minute. He asked me where I'm from. I tell him Lake Pontchartrain, Louisiana. He says that he's also from somewhere.
Soon as you say I'm from somewhere, he goes, I'm also from somewhere.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, you guys are connected.
Yeah, connected.
You're both smokers. You're both from somewhere.
Absolutely. So we sit there. We talk for a bit. We talk about our hopes and dreams and goals.
Such as what?
Well, I played a year of basketball at Louisiana Lafayette. I had to return home because my father had lost his other leg.
Both legs he lost?
Yeah. There was a bucket full of phosphates. He stuck his leg in it and melted right off.
Any particular reason he stuck his leg in there?
Somebody had put a blindfold on him. He was probably looking for a pinata. It was his birthday.
Terrible way to celebrate your birthday, burning your leg off in a bucket of phosphate.
Well, to be fair, he did eventually find the pinata.
He kept going?
Yeah. He's a tough man. Lost that first leg in Korea. Didn't even cry.
Oh, my gosh.
So I had to come home. Wasn't able to continue on my dreams, but he asked
Please thank him for his service at the phosphate plant.
Well, he's passed on, so it'll be a posthumous thank you.
All right, so tell me about this guy.
He asked me, he said, if you could go anywhere in the world you ever wanted to go to, where would it be? I said, a lot of places. I'd like to go to Korea, potentially get my father's leg back, see if they still got it somewhere, ask a few questions.
Yeah, you got a canvas. You go door to door and say, you seen a leg?
Yeah, and I'd be willing to do that. Although I don't know if they have doors in Korea.
I bet they do.
Maybe some houses have them. Other houses just have beads.
God damn it!
Do I need my lawyer to come inside?
No, you're not under suspicion of a goddamn crime.
You're getting a little spicy with me, okay?
I just want us to focus on what happened. This guy's been going around killing people. You're the only lead I have. I need you to tell me what happened.
All right. Well, here's what happened next. Our cigarettes were still going. Neither one of us had ashed them yet. It became sort of a competition to see who could collect the most ash on the end of the cigarette.
Spoken or unspoken?
Unspoken.
So you don't even know that was necessarily going through his mind. He might have just forgot.
Well, that's definitely what I was doing. And I believe that when he looked over and saw that that's what I was doing, he chose not to ash his either.
Please don't tell me what you believe, because none of that is usable in court. Just tell me the facts.
I'll tell you the facts. The facts is we let our cigarettes get long ash. And I believe that we were in a competition with each other.
I said, don't tell me what you believe.
Okay, well then next, he said, where else would you like to go? And I told him, I said, China. He said, I can help you get there. I said, oh, sir, I'm just a lowly shrimp sheller. I don't have the money to get all the way to China, sir. I don't
so this make... guy's some kind of travel agent?
That's what I thought when he told me that. And I said, sir, I don't have the money to take a trip to China. You see, I only make $325,000 a year.
What the fuck?
What's the issue?
You make $325,000 a year and you can't afford a goddamn plane ticket to China?
$240,000 of that goes to child support.
It's a lot of children.
Oh, yes. I have a lot of children.
Anyway, you want to go to China? This guy says I can help you out.
He told me he had a ticket. He said, just follow me. So we get to this place. It's empty.
I'm going to stop you for a second and just ask, were you at all suspicious at this point?
At this point, we had developed such a rapport between him asking me what my hopes and dreams were, him telling me he was from somewhere, also us having this, what I believe to be a competition.
The ash competition.
The ash competition.
Which could have existed only in your head.
I believe it was both of us.
Please stop saying I believe.
Well, I do believe
that's useless to me. I want facts.
I don't not believe it.
Now that's a fact. But go ahead.
So, I follow him to an empty lot. He says, well, the ticket is over there in that hole. Now I'm becoming suspicious.
Thank fucking God.
He says that you can go all the way to China if you get in that hole there and you dig your way down.
So you're getting into the hole?
Mm-hmm. I get in there and then he starts pouring dirt on top of me. I say, now, hold on. Wait a second, sir. I kind of leaned against the wall of this hole. Now, he didn't want to get down there with me, I'm assuming, so he just let me stand there, and he thought he could cover me up altogether, mm-hmm. which is why I felt like I could still breathe a little bit, because technically, me being 6'3", top of my head was above the ground that he had filled. It was about 6 feet tall.
Yao Ming is Chinese.
7'5".
Way taller than you.
But I don't think he'd be there. He's still in Houston.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, I get out. I say, that was odd.
That's what you said?
Mm-hmm.
You weren't flustered or upset or screaming or angry?
Well, I could have gotten angry, but then I remember what my dad used to tell me. I lost my leg in Korea, and I don't get angry. And I lost another leg to hot phosphates, and I don't get angry. I still hit the pinata. So in that moment, I had to still hit the pinata. So I
walked
up.
Where did the pinata come from?
Oh, my dad's birthday.
It was your dad's birthday while you're getting in the hole?
No. That was a metaphor that my father was.
God damn it! Stop it with the literary devices. Just tell me what the fuck happened that made you call the tip line.
Well, once I had seen that there was a tip line set up about somebody getting buried, I said, well, somebody tried to do that to me, too. Now, if this is a trend, I believe that I should have talked to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
How's that?
That's great. What you've done here is a great thing.
Do I need to call my lawyer in here?
You actually do. I have a summons here. We're going to actually place you under arrest on your way out.
You got to be kidding me.
For unpaid child support.
$240,000 a year.
Yeah, well, you're still behind. I don't know what to tell you. I don't make the rules.
I was going to offer you a shrimp dinner.
I'd still like to take you up on that.
If you're buying, I'm shelling.
Ugh.
There's a whole lot more when the long story continues. From his interview with Hendrix Murphy, it was pretty easy for Detective Ramsey to find Cactus Tony. Between his unusual name and his distinctive style of dress, a lot of people in this town had taken notice of him. One night, at the Arclight movie theater, Cactus Tony was taken into custody. He genuinely seemed to have no idea why. I'll let Cactus Tony pick it up from there. I reached him at the San Quentin Correctional Facility in Marin County, California, where he had settled in nicely and was making a lot of friends. Hello, are you able to hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me all right? It's crazy here. I'm in jail. Do you know that? I'm literally in jail, so it's very crazy here. Everybody here is basically a criminal, and but some of them are fine. There's some decent guys here, and we just kind of, I don't know, we just play checkers all day long, and sometimes we'll play Twister and just kind of get down on the floor and tangle up and just laugh and giggle. We do have a pretty good time, but all in all, I'd rather be out of here.
I hear you.
And I'll tell you one nice thing. You know, when I first got here, they put me in, you know how you get the orange jumpsuit? Everybody here is in an orange jumpsuit, and I said, I can't wear this. I only wear snakeskin. I mean, head to toe, always. I've always just worn snakeskin. And I just, so I went to the warden and I took a real formal meeting with him. I laid out all the reasons that I can't wear this jumpsuit, and they were nice enough to make me an orange snakeskin jumpsuit. And I mean, that was a real major concession to me, and I'm real thankful for it. And so, in some ways, I feel almost like it would be a betrayal to leave here, but on the other hand, I really do want to go.
Well, it sounds like you're making some friends, though.
I have made some friends, yeah. And to tell you the truth, it's not the first time I've been in jail. And, when you come back to jail, it's like, who's still here? You know what I mean? It's like a high school reunion. Who's still in high school 10, 20 years later? But here in jail, there's definitely guys that I've had a couple of real cool reunions with people. It's just like, I can't believe you're here. I can't believe you're still here or here again in some cases. Because how it is when somebody's a criminal? Sometimes they just is, and there's nothing you can do. And they saw it, and that's all they know.
Right. No, I totally get that.
Yeah, but anyways, as I say, all in all, when I really look at it and I make up like a real thorough pro-con list, I'd rather be out.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I wanted to kind of talk to you today, if you don't mind discussing the case.
I don't mind at all. I'm so glad that Don DeMello got in touch with you, because, Don, I'm really surprised that he just went on a limb like that and he just tried to sort this out for me, because to tell you the truth, Don and I sometimes have been butting heads here and there. That's real sweet of him that he reached out to you. And so, yeah, I'd love to do anything I can do to clear my name of this murder, because I don't think I committed it. I don't think I committed a murder, you know. And I was real surprised that they found me guilty, because I put on a defense in that trial. I mean, I'm very proud of the defense that I put on. It was spectacular, and it was thorough, and it was riveting, and it was exciting, and I got to the courthouse on time every single day, mostly. So when they said guilty, I said, there's been a mistake.
I had the opportunity to review the court transcript.
Oh, you did?
I did.
Yeah.
I was really interested that you chose to defend yourself.
Yeah, of course I did. Of course I defended myself, because they said, we'll give you a lawyer. And I said to myself, well, I'm a lawyer. Now, I'm not, but... I felt that I was, because I've seen so much law stuff. You ever watch TV?
I love TV, yeah. I watch a lot of TV. My fiance and I do.
Yeah, oh yeah, which mostly lawyers. And so I felt like, I think I basically have a handle on this, and nobody could represent. Why put a middleman in there? Get rid of the middleman. I have something to say, I'm going to say it. And I did a great job. Everybody told me, Cactus Tony, you did a great job representing yourself as a lawyer. I don't know if anybody said it, but I felt that way.
Cactus Tony, if you have the time, I'd love to go back to the week of the crime.
Yeah. What do you mean? How are you going to go back?
Oh, I just know maybe...
I'm willing to do it, but I don't know how... What's your plan? Do you have a plan to go back?
I wasn't intending to actually go back. I just wanted to discuss with you what you remember.
Oh, uh-huh. Yes. Okay. So, look, I mean, here's the deal. I mean, the date that they say that this happened, that whole period of time is a period of time in my life when I have no memories, and I can't recall anything at all for a period of a couple of weeks, probably. But that's not so unusual for me. I have periods of time where I just don't remember anything at all, and it's partly because I don't have a brain that functions like a lot of other people's brains. Partly because I don't really sleep. I'm typically up 22 hours a day, and it's also because in order to maintain that lifestyle, that sleep-free lifestyle, because I fully believe that sleep is killing us. Sleep, if you want to look at the one thing that cuts down people's life expectancy, it's sleep.
Really?
So I don't do it. I don't believe in it. But, from time to time, I will fall asleep. But anyways, in order to maintain that no-sleep lifestyle, I do need a high volume of pills that are designed to stimulate the adrenal gland to keep a person up. So, as pertains to is the fact of vis-a-vis that, my brain sometimes has periods of not recording memories.
So are you telling me that you remember nothing from the week of the murder?
Yeah, and so when the cops said, well, where were you on this night and all that stuff, I just had to laugh and say, you got to be kidding me. I don't know where I was, during that whole time. But I was able to remember, and actually I had a receipt from a time that I went to Tommy's Chili Burgers about 2 weeks before the murder, and then a time that I went to 21 Choices. You ever been to 21 Choices over there in Colorado, in Old Town?
Yeah, I go there with my nieces.
Yeah, I mean, when you go in that place... You need to make 21 choices every time you go in there, because they got 21 flavors, and you need to actively choose. I'm not going to have that one. I'm not going to have that one. You need to make 20 negative choices, and you need to make one affirmative choice. And so that's the best truth advertising I've ever seen on the site. You need to make 21 choices. And so you got to be ready for that. And you got to be mentally prepared to do it, because a lot of people can't handle that. And so, yeah, I have a receipt from a time that I was there. So in other words, based on paper documentation, and I was able to supply this to the court, I can tell you where I was about 2 weeks before that murder happened and another place I was about 9 days after. Is that, well, what was your question?
No offense, but do you see how it might seem a little convenient to people that you have no recollection of that week?
Oh, it's extremely inconvenient, actually, because, it's hard to not remember things. But, yeah, What do you mean? Like, I can't. They said, where were you on the night of the thing? And I can't tell them anything.
Right.
And that makes you seem bad.
It makes you seem a little guilty.
I suppose so. But then again, if you think about all the things I could have been doing, we're murdering that guy is only one of them. I mean, it starts to seem like, you know, I could have been knitting a sweater. I could have been participating in a drag race. I could have been surfing. I could have been whale watching. I could have been digging a hole to put somebody else in. I could have been, you know what I'm saying? In other words, there's a million different things that I could have been doing, and murdering that guy is only one of them. So that's, I feel like, when you put it that way, the chances of me having done it is astronomical.
I never thought about it like that.
Yeah. I mean, literally, what you're doing right now is the one thing that you're doing, but it is amongst, like, hundreds of things you could be doing. See what I mean?
I think I do.
Yeah. And that was part of my closing statement. I made a list, and I went on for about... I went one whole day, and then I come back and I did another half day, just a list of things that I might have been doing instead of murdering that guy. And some of the things I mentioned there was on there, but I could have been tending a garden, you know. I could have been cutting somebody's hair. I could have been going for a long walk. I could have been going for a short walk. I could have been going for a medium-sized walk. You know what I'm saying? So I went for a whole day and a half listing things I might have been doing instead of murdering that guy. And that was a powerful closing statement.
I hear you.
But anyways, you know, I listened to a lot of the evidence that the prosecution... Because, you know, I don't know if you know how trial works, but the prosecution has a chance to say, here's why I think he did it, which I think is wrong. But... they had the chance to do that, and I sat there, and I paid attention to, I'd say, conservative estimate. I listened carefully to about half of it, and none of it really seemed like a slam dunk on their part. They weren't able to, like, say, oh, you know, somebody saw him do it, or somebody, he did, now we got a fingerprint and all that. I didn't hear any of that. So when they gave it to the jury, I said, well, jury, you know, and I told them, I said, jury, you know, they're going to ask you to make up your mind whether I murdered this guy, and you'd be a bunch of fucking idiots to say that I did. And I looked each one of them in the eye, and I pointed right at them, and I said, I'm studying your face. Don't fuck up. And then for some reason, the judge thought that was wrong, and I had to leave. But, I was shocked when the jury turned around and said I did it. How do they know?
You don't believe you got a fair trial.
I don't know. I know for a fact I didn't get a fair trial. A fair trial would have been, I go in and say, look, I have no memory of whether I did this thing or not, but what are the chances that I did? Slim. And then you don't give the other side a chance to say, oh, here's why we think he did it. That's not fair. You see how that makes the jury go, oh, wait a minute, maybe he did. You know what I'm saying? That's not fair. And so, in my view, I would just explain to them, like, come on. And then they would say, yeah, all right.
Why you?
Why me? That's a great question. Why me? Well, part of it is that I have in the past pushed people inside holes that I have dug and covered them over with dirt. And that's something I've done. I've done that many, many times. And so you could almost understand why, if something like that happens, they might say, well, where's the guy that we know who's done that before, you know? And so in that sense, I guess I could understand where they might think it was me, you know? But it just happens that in this case, I don't think it was, in my opinion.
Do you think you might have been framed?
Oh, no doubt about it. What's framed?
Set up.
Yeah,
you know,
made
to seem like you did it when you didn't.
Oh, it's the only possible explanation. Because, like, let's say, I don't know, if you was going to kill somebody, how would you do it?
Me?
Yeah, how would you do it?
A gun?
Yeah, okay. So let's say that you are known to have a history of shooting people with a gun.
I don't.
Okay, but let's just imagine that you are.
Okay.
I something tells me that you are. But let's imagine that you are known to have a history of shooting people with a gun. And somebody says, I wanted to make that Alex go to jail. And so they might shoot somebody with a gun. And then everybody would know, oh, I know who it is. It's that person that's known for shooting people with a gun. So that's the thing that I think happened to me. Because if you want to be, because I am, as I say, I'm fairly well known for digging holes and pushing people in it and burying them with dirt. And if you want to put me in jail specifically, then what's a great way to go about doing it? Do just what I have been known to do from time to time.
Is there anyone you can think of who would want you out of the picture?
Well, there's a lot of people that don't like me very much, you know. I mean, I have a job. One of my jobs is that I work for the night manager at the Hollywood Arclight, and I give hand jobs to people that are there to see the movies. And there's another guy who I know wants my job. He's been gunning for it for a long time, and so I think of him first and foremost. That guy's like, because I know for a fact that he's doing it now. Now that I'm in jail, he has my job, and that was a sweet job because I got free popcorn every night for giving out those hand jobs. And let's see, who else? There might be, you know, as a child care manager for Don DeMello Productions, there have been a fair number of mishaps whereupon children have simply not been there at the end of the play. They're not, I don't know where they went, and I don't have them anymore. And other times when things have happened that, you know, you return them, but not in the state that they were in when you got them. So there's parents that's mad at me because, you know, you ever have that experience where somebody says, look after my child, and then they show up to come bring them back, and the child is either gone or doesn't have all the parts on him that he had. Now, that's going to make a parent mad. So I've got angry parents at me all the time. But also, you know, I mean, Don is always talking about how, like, people in this town don't like him. And, you know, and if they're trying to get, you know, you can't get at Don. I mean, if you're going to go for the king, you best shoot straight at him. You know what I'm saying? What's that expression? You want to try and kick, you got to try to take down the king. You're going to get the king. Go ahead and get the king. But do it right. Make it good. Right? Is that the expression?
Something like that.
Please kill our king. But when you do it, don't fuck up. Is that the expression?
I'm not sure, honestly, Tony.
But you know what I'm saying. If you're going to go for the top dog, you can't fail. And I think, you know, Don, you can't take Don down. You can't take Don down. Lots of people tried it. I understand where somebody that didn't like Don would go for me instead. And that's what I think is going on. That's what I think is going on.
You were one of the 21 choices.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Whether to frame me for murder or not was one of somebody's 21 choices, and they decided, yep.
Oh, I gotta run. It was great talking to you.
Well, it was great talking to you, and am I free? Can I go?
Unfortunately, I can't make that call for you, Mr. Cactus Tony.
Oh, I was under the impression that I just needed to explain some things to you and you would get me out of jail.
I'm a journalist, but I want to get to the bottom of what's going on with your case. I really do.
I thought you were a jury nullifier of some kind.
I'm not.
You can't do that.
I'm sorry, I'm not.
Well, then, excuse me, but what was the point of this phone conversation? There's a rousing game of they're doing Connect Four over there in the common area, and I was...
Do you listen to podcasts?
No, I don't listen to whatever that is. I don't... No.
I'm doing an investigative podcast.
Okay, great.
About your case.
Oh, you are? And when do I get out? I'm just not clear as to when I get out of jail.
Well, let's plan to talk next Thursday.
Oh, okay. And then I'll just pack up my things and just be ready to go on Thursday. As I say, I mean, it's fine here. I really do like a lot of these guys, but all in all, when it really come down to it, you know, if I just have 21 choices about whether to stay here or not, I think all 21 times I'd say I'd like to go.
Well, you hang tight, all right? You do your job, I'll do mine.
Okay, what's my job?
Hand jobs, right?
Oh, that's funny. I haven't even tried to do that here in jail, but that's a good idea. Thank you. You gave me a good idea.
Oh, no.
I'm going to start giving out hand jobs for cigarettes. That's a good idea. All right. Thank you, Mary. I'm glad we talked. Why didn't I even think about it? I've got a skill. I'm not using it here in jail. All right. So I'm going to do that, and then you're going to do your job. What's your job?
I do an investigatory podcast.
Oh, you're going to have to tell me that again because I didn't quite get it. But don't tell me now because I won't get it. But all right. Well, best of luck, and I look forward to coming and seeing you on Thursday.
Oh, okay. I'll phone you.
Okay,
talk
great.
Soon.
All right. See you on the phone. Bye.
Okay, good night. Cactus Tony's trial was videotaped by our local news station, and I was able to review the footage. It's the strangest trial I've ever seen in my life, and I've served on jury duty twice and followed the OJ thing pretty closely, too, and that was really weird. Remember that whole thing with the glove? Anyway, Cactus Tony's was weirder. The prosecution had no physical evidence linking Cactus Tony to the crime, but they laid out their circumstantial evidence in a very damning way, and they managed to depict Cactus Tony not as a caring, if eccentric, children's theater childcare provider, but as something much more unseemly.
The defendant, ladies and gentlemen, is nothing more than a common vagrant.
Objection, Your Honor. A vagrant dressed in snakeskin is not a common vagrant.
Order. Mr. Tony, if you speak out of turn again, I'll have you out of this courtroom in a flash.
And that's the other thing. Remember when Cactus Tony said he acted as his own lawyer? Well, he probably shouldn't have.
All rise.
Objection! I just sat down and I really haven't had a chance to take a load off all morning.
Your Honor, may I approach the bench?
Objection! His breath is terrible today, Your Honor. If I were you, I'd be careful. Your Honor, I'd like to call a brief recess so I can find out this girl's name.
No, Mr. Tony. Only the judge can do that.
Okay, well then tell me what it is when you find out.
Order!
Poor Cactus Tony. He was obviously not a lawyer and was in way over his head and totally lost. A lot of the time, he didn't even seem to be paying attention to his own trial. He was constantly taking off his shirt or falling asleep and snoring loudly, or trying to make out with one particular juror who eventually had to pepper spray him and it almost caused a mistrial. Maybe it should have. The prosecution spent several days laying out their evidence, and then it was Cactus Tony's turn. As you'll hear, he didn't exactly present a thorough or effective case for himself. I'm going to play his entire defense for you, just so you know exactly what the jury was faced with when they went into deliberations.
Your Honor, are we still calling you that? After yesterday, you lost your cool. That wasn't very honorable. But anyway, yeah, I'm ready to call my witness for the defense. I have only one witness, ladies and gentlemen. That's how bad their case was, in my opinion. How incredibly bad the prosecution case. They didn't make any kind of case at all, and all I need to do is call one witness and pop the whole balloon. You know what I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen, jury? You ever have a balloon and blow it up real big, and then somebody come along just with a pen, and all they need is one pen. You don't need a whole ton of pens to pop a balloon. And that's why I meant to bring a balloon. Oh, that's right. They didn't let me bring a balloon in here from the jail. Or a pen, let alone a pen. Anyhow, where was I? Thank you. Yes, I'm going to call my one and only witness and going to just make it very clear that I didn't do this. Ladies and gentlemen, however, my witness is two witnesses. I can't, because they are a team and they always come as a team. You can't get one without the other, and they made that very clear. That's in their contract, and they are being paid to be here today. Ladies and gentlemen, my one and only witnesses are Milton and Dupree.
Dupree, are we on?
I get on. Hey, Phyllis, thank you so much for being here. Why don't you tell the folks of the jury a little bit about yourselves, you know, just to give them some background and also how we know each other.
We know who we are, but who are you?
Come on now. Cactus Tony. You remember me, Cactus Tony? Uh-huh. But you guys are Milton and Dupree. You're a couple of entertainers, aren't you?
We're a vaudeville duo.
That did vaudeville.
As a duo.
And we worked the circuit from 1921 until
1922.
Until our deaths in 1922.
We think.
No, you guys are still here. You're still alive. Oh. And that's a big point. If you're dead, that'd be bad for me. That would make you bad witnesses. But you guys are alive, and that makes you good witnesses for me, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. Wait till you hear their story. But if you find yourself laughing or tapping your toe along, well, don't be surprised, because that's because they are wonderful entertainers, and that's just a side benefit of their testimony today.
Hey, Milton.
Yeah, Dupree.
What did the courtroom do when the bailiff said, "All rise"?
What?
I don't know.
What? Everybody stood up, I think, right?
We've got a bailiff. Why don't we ask him?
We should talk to him. Excuse me, bailiff. Oh, leave him alone. All right, look. Now, so you guys, you remember the time that we met. We met down at the bus station. You guys were going, I don't know where you guys were going, but you didn't have your banjo on you at the time, so I don't know if you were going to a show, but you must have just been going maybe grocery shop or something like that. You take the bus?
Sure we do. That's how I get sick.
That's how you get sick, is taking the bus?
That's how I get married.
How
many times you been married?
How many times he got? That's why we were in court.
One time we were getting an annulment.
We accidentally got married once.
The two of you got married one time accidentally?
In Reno.
In Reno. Well, that's what's going to happen to Reno. Just stay out of Reno. I learned that a long time ago. Don't go anywhere near Reno. Anyways, we met on the bus. I was taking a bus with you guys because I had to get from my one job looking after kids to my other job and giving hand jobs at the Arclight movie theater.
Are you a hand job salesman?
Well, actually, another guy usually sets them up. I just do them, but... I'm a hand job practitioner.
Oh.
And I met you guys there, and you guys were talking about how you've traveled all over the world except for one place.
Yeah, there's one place in the world we've never been.
Ever.
Okay.
But here's the kicker.
Yeah?
We don't remember.
Okay. Well, that's fine. That's no problem. I remember you guys were telling me you had never been to China. You never made it to China.
I'd love to go there one day.
Well, you did. Remember that?
Oh, we did.
Do you remember? So, look, ladies and gentlemen, the jury, these guys are very old, and so there's a lot of things that they may not remember, but you don't hold that against them, because that is called age sexism, and it is incorrect, and you're not supposed to do it, as ladies and gentlemen of the jury. So now, you guys were just talking to me, you've never been to China, and you've been all over. You were telling me countries you had been to. You had been to Canada, you had been to Chile, you had been to New Jersey.
China.
You had been, no, you told me you had been to China.
No, because we were supposed to play Roy Chapman Andrews' Camp in the Gobi Desert, and then he got cheap on us.
Is that right? That's why you never made it to China?
Yeah, he apparently went out and bought himself a new pair of jodhpurs instead of hiring us to come over.
And he sent us one thing of swag, and it was, I went to China, and all I got was these lousy set of Mao Tse tongs.
Well, that sounds... I'd be happy to wear that if it was made of snakeskin. But anyways, when I remember, you guys told me you'd never been to China.
That's right. That's
what
definitely
I do,
correct.
When somebody tells me they've never been to China, what? You remember what I did? Do you have any idea what I offered to do?
He gave us two first-class tickets on a SST, and it was one of the nicest things anyone had ever done for us.
Incorrect. Oh. Incorrect. Oh. Nope, your memory on that is faulty. But, ladies and gentlemen, jury, don't hold that against them. Now, what I did was I says let's get off this bus. I know just where to get off. And I'm going to take you guys, and we're going to go to China. I'm going to get you guys to China. And do you remember? And I went, first I had to go to a hardware store and pick up a shovel.
Right.
Okay.
I remember that.
Right. And you guys, I don't know where you were headed on that bus, but you gave up going there because you said, hell, I'm more interested to go to China.
Oh, we were going to China on the bus, were we?
Were you taking the bus to China?
I think so.
We were taking the slow bus to China.
Yeah, that's right. It was taking a long time.
It really was.
Yeah, it was going to take a long time. But so I had a much faster way.
Yeah, I remember this now.
And I took you guys to the park, and you remember I was digging a hole, right? And it took a long damn time to dig a hole. And you guys, as I recall, you guys fell asleep under a tree. You got a good sleep while I dug the hell out of this hole, just working and working and working, because I knew you guys was old, and I didn't think you was going to help me dig a hole. Anyway, I dug a real deep hole, and I lifted you guys up, just cradling you like babies, and I threw you into the hole. You remember that? I threw you both in there.
I remember landing.
Yeah, I remember. That was hard.
Yeah.
And I fell on my gardening claw, which I had with me, because I picked it up at the 99-cent
store.
What?
Yeah, huh? So, yeah, I remember that, too. See, now we're remembering things. Because I remember you guys both woke up once you hit the bottom of the hole I had dug. And I had dug it real deep, too. And you got, so you hit with a real thud, and that woke you up. And I remember you screaming out, my side hurts. Anyways, now I started to put the dirt on top of you guys, right? I started, now just as these folks have heard from other witnesses, I dug a hole and I put somebody in it and I threw dirt on top of them.
And at first we didn't even balk because we're so old we figured this is long since due.
I thought it was raining.
I thought it was raining death, finally. And so the bummer was we didn't die, but the bonus was, and I don't want to spoil it.
Joe, go ahead and tell them, because this is the whole reason I brought you guys here, because this is going to crack this case wide open and prove I'm innocent. Go ahead and tell them.
Eventually, we went to China.
We dug our way.
Is that right? You told us to say that?
Now, this is one thing that this courtroom has not heard about me and the practice of digging holes and throwing people in them and burying them. I never do it without that I tell the person, keep digging, you'll make it to China.
Okay, now I can't throw in the shovel because I need the shovel to cover you over to close the portal to China so it doesn't just become thousands of people streaming into the portal to China. But I told you guys, and I was glad to hear you had a gardening tool at the time, keep digging and you'll make it down there to China. And now a lot of folks, we heard from a witness who says he didn't do that. He scratched and clawed his way out. Now he's mad at me for some damn reason. But you guys did as instructed.
We had no choice. We were facing down.
Yeah.
We couldn't turn around. That's too much energy. We should dig to China, we says.
That's right.
It was really a logical choice, and that's rare, because logic eludes me most of the time.
Yeah, so all I know about that event was that I had thrown a bunch of that dirt back in that hole, and then I believe somebody came along, and I saw, and I thought, shit, I got to get out of here. So I ran away, and I never thought about you guys. I figured maybe they made it to China, or maybe they didn't. I really don't know. But now, tell us about the times you had in China.
Oh, what a treat. We went to Oktoberfest.
We saw the Louvre.
Yes. We went to a luau.
And we ate dirt in Reykjavik.
We went to Burning Man.
And, cooling woman.
And lukewarm, gender-fluid person.
And that was probably the easiest to get around in. All you had to do was wear a serape and a thong.
But just to let the court know how real this all was,
yes,
that we actually went to China and that this is bona fide, they have a different type of checkers there.
They have a different type of checkers there. Did everybody hear that on the jury?
You wouldn't know it unless you'd been there.
See that? There's literally no way of knowing about Chinese checkers without having to been to China to find out about it.
There was another thing. We got arrested for indecent exposure.
Oh, you did?
Technically, it was decent exposure.
That's correct.
They were jealous.
But you were arrested with me because we had to make you decent. We had to make me indecent. And they had a special kind of handcuffs.
Yeah, but they're finger cuffs. And since we were naked, they didn't use them on our finger.
It was really hard to walk sideways for 3 or 4 hours.
See that? Now, that would only happen in China, ladies and gentlemen. Now you know they was in China.
You have no idea what it's like walking through town naked, finger cuffed by the phallus, and letting all sorts of little Chinese children play limbo under you like so many Harry Belafontes. And speaking of our Harry Belafontes, they were sore as could be.
Well, don't be so sure that I don't know what that's like, but I'll bet you a lot of folks on the jury don't. Don't judge them because, you know, when in China, do like the Chinese do.
And walk like an Egyptian.
And walk like an Egyptian.
And we experienced General Chow's chicken. And I'm going to give you a hint. It's not a dessert.
We also went to Panda Express, but there it's just called our regular bear express.
The panda bear is not an exotic bear to the Chinese.
No, that's
They're
right.
used to them.
Yeah.
They just walk around the streets all the time, right? The panda bears in China.
That's true.
They're just as common as dogs and cats and pigeons.
And P.F. Chang's there is just called P.F. Smith's.
That's what they would call it. See that, folks?
And it's American food.
And it's American food. You see that, folks? If you was even sitting there wondering, did they really make it to China? You know they did now, because there's P.F. Smith's. What do they serve? Hot dogs.
Hot dogs.
Corn dogs.
Yeah.
Cold cats.
Yeah, cold cats.
And lukewarm.
Mini fridges. They had, it's not crab rangoon. It's, lobster parfait. It's a little gross.
Yeah, if you go to China, first thing you want to order is the It's Not Crab Rangoon, It's Lobster Parfait.
I can't believe it's not crab rangoon.
It's not crab rangoon.
That's right.
Yeah. So definitely we've been to China, and also look at my nails. They're missing from digging.
Uh-huh, see that? There you go. His nails look terrible. And that's not just from being old. That's from having been buried in the earth and having to dig straight through to China. Do you guys remember the middle of the earth? What was that like when you passed through the middle of the earth?
There were
a lot of hobbits.
Yeah, and Mordites or
Mordites,
whatever they're called.
A lot of Mordites.
Mordites.
Yeah.
They have a third eye.
The third eye. So there's creatures down there in the middle of the earth with a third eye.
Oh, yeah. Almost certainly.
See that? Now, you couldn't know that unless you'd actually done this journey, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. What are y'all rolling your eyes at me for? These people on jury just...
They've been rude to me throughout the trial.
Everybody calm down, because Lala Galibrand will be up later doing a jiggle dance. So if you're not enjoying this act, there's going to be something. Every 10 minutes we turn this over, we know how to work a music hall.
We really do. Remember when Hebrew the National would get up and do his phallus dance?
Hebrew the National?
I wish I'd call him as a witness. I'd love to see that act.
That's his elected position.
I screwed up. I only called one. Damn it. I should have called a magician and a singing duo, too. I made a mistake. I only called up the one act.
Well, we do sing.
And we do dance.
All right. Well, you want to hit us with one of your numbers?
Sure.
Here we go.
Here we go.
This one is called That Gal in the Front Row. And take it away, Milton.
All right. She's got one eye and she's missing a nose, and her fingers only line up with her toes, and she's shaped like a crustacean from under the sea. That gal in the front row is the gal for me. Oh,
thank you. We wrote that in 19.5 seconds ago.
Well, I think that I couldn't have asked for a better witness in my defense than Milton and Dupree. Couldn't thank you more for coming down here and demonstrating to the ladies and gentlemen of the jury that if they was to even think about convicting me for this murder, they would be 12 assholes. And so you guys did a great job of making that perfectly clear.
Thank you very much. Thank you for trying to bury us.
My pleasure. I'm glad. You don't need to thank me for sending you to China. I truly enjoy doing it.
And where do we get our payment voucher for this show?
I'll give it to you right here in cash. I'll pay you right here in cash.
This is a great circuit. We'll work for you anytime.
Yeah, okay, right. That sounds good. I hope to never be on trial again, but if I am, you guys will definitely come back. Here we go. It's 100, 200, 300.
Whoa. We've never made this much in our entire lives, Your Honor.
Collectively.
Fantastic. Well, with that payment out of the way, Your Honor, the defense rests. That's how you win a goddamn trial.
Cactus Tony's strategy didn't work at all. The jury deliberated for exactly 3 seconds. They didn't even leave the jury box. And Cactus Tony has been behind bars ever since. It would be easy enough to just forget about a guy like Cactus Tony. He seems a little weird, right? And it sure sounds like he has a habit of burying people alive. He also seems pretty happy behind bars, so maybe everything worked out okay. But tell that to Don DeMello, who really cares about Tony and is struggling to keep his business going without him. And it's not just him. Cactus Tony has a girlfriend, too. And I caught up with her backstage at a Peter Cetera concert. That interview, when the long story continues.
Thank you.
Cactus Irene, thank you for sitting down with me.
I'm excited to be here.
I wanted to talk to you a little bit about Cactus Tony.
Oh, Cactus Tony, my main man. I love him so much.
We've been having phone conversations every once in a while to discuss his case. Have you been able to get in touch with him since he's been in prison?
We have this one payphone that we love to just use. And so sometimes I'll go and I'll just wait by the payphone and hope that Tony will call me. But it's been pretty tough, if I can be honest with you. It's been pretty tough lately.
I'm sure it has. I can't even imagine. Well, he only has great things to say about you.
Oh, like what?
He just says he misses you.
Oh, I miss him so much. I miss his musk, but it's like, it's kind of gasoline smell. You know the smell of gasoline. You ever huffed it?
I've smelt it by accident.
You should try huffing it.
Uh-huh. So why don't you tell me a little bit about your relationship with Cactus Tony?
Oh, yeah. Well, we met back in 1982. We were at a club where men were dressing as ladies. What? What? And then as we were getting kicked out, he was like, I'm Cactus Tony. And I was like, what? I'm Cactus Irene. And ever since then, we've just had a beautiful romance.
And are you called Cactus Irene for the same reason he's called Cactus Tony? Which I don't even know.
I'm called Cactus Irene because I used to fight cactuses. And Tony's called Cactus Tony because he used to make love to cactuses. So we're your classic yin and yang.
That's really beautiful.
Thank you.
Now, I want to talk a little bit about the case.
Yes.
Do you think that Cactus Tony is innocent?
Yes. Yes, because... Oh, wait, will you hold on, please? They're playing our favorite song, If You Leave Me Now. And this, like, the symbolism, right? Because if he leaves me now, what am I gonna do?
He's not.
Shh, this is my favorite song. But what am I gonna do if he leaves me now?
I don't know.
Shh, this is my favorite song.
Did you wanna go out?
Shh.
To watch?
I don't wanna watch. I only wanna hear it.
Thank you so much for meeting me during the concert.
Shh. We gotta listen. Why would you agree to come to an interview at a concert?
It was my producer's idea, Peter Cetera.
I know when Tony has done something wrong. I know when he's guilty.
How?
Because have you seen those dog videos when, like, people film their dogs being clearly guilty of, like, eating a pillow?
Oh, yeah, I've seen those on YouTube.
Yeah, right? They're very cute. Cactus Tony is just like those dogs. So I think he's innocent, even though he's loved burying people alive before.
But in the past, when he's buried people alive, you could tell.
Yeah, he'd be, like, covered in dirt and being like, they're on their way to China, and stuff like that, and guilty.
What do you think Cactus Tony loves so much about burying people alive?
You know, I think he feels like he's truly helping them by burying them alive, you know? I think he feels, you know, because you look at Darth Vader doesn't think he's bad, right? Or does he? I've never seen one of those Star Wars movies. Does Darth Vader think he's bad?
I've never seen any of those movies either.
It makes sense.
But
it,
this time... You know he's innocent.
Yes.
Okay, but you're shaking your head no when you say yes.
No, I'm not.
Okay, now you're shaking your head yes, but you're saying no. What are you not telling me? Now it's going side to side. Are you okay?
I'm fine. Tony's an innocent man, and he will get out, and I will fight to make him get out.
Is there anything else about the week of the murder? Because Cactus Tony seems to remember nothing about that week. Were you with him at all?
Yes, I was. I was there for a lot of it, and can I be honest? I don't remember much of it.
Okay, and why don't you remember anything?
I have this thing. I huffed a bunch of gas early on in my life, and so I now forget stuff pretty easily. Have you ever huffed a bunch of gas?
No, you already asked me that. I have not.
Oh, you should try it.
I'll make sure to
you
do that.
You should really try it. It fucks you up.
Sure, I'll make sure to do
in
that.
In, like, a weird way. But, yeah, so I do remember going to a crab shack with Tony, and we did all-you-can-eat crab. Have you ever done all-you-can-eat crab?
In Vegas, I have.
Ooh, Vegas crab. That's risky. Good for you. That's cool. I don't even think Cactus Irene would try that. But, so we went to an all-you-can-eat crab shack. And you know, like, when you eat a bunch of meat, you get, like, meat sweats. Well, I started getting the crab sweats, and I had to get out of there quick. Have you ever had crab sweats?
I'm sure I have, but I can't remember.
You would know if you had. You would know exactly what I'm talking about. It was Adam. So I had to get out of there quick and go lay down in the park right next to it. So I just went and laid down on the slide. A lot of kids were very upset with me, but I just kept screaming at them, like, get out of here! I need to do this! Because that cool metal of the slide really helps with your crab sweats. If you ever get them, find a slide.
And that's the last time you saw Cactus Tony?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Okay, again, you're nodding no.
It was the last time I saw Tony.
No.
No.
Well, if you remember anything else, Cactus Irene, feel free to give me a phone call.
Okay. We have a good, rapport at Home Depot.
Who does? You and...
Me and Cactus Tony. We go there often and buy shovels.
Are you saying that you assist in some of these live burials?
No.
You're nodding again.
Oh, man. Shoot. No.
I'm not trying to catch you in any lie. I'm just trying to get to the bottom of what happened to your boyfriend.
Thank you. Let's just say he's innocent.
You're shaking your head, just so the listeners know.
Oh, don't tell them. They don't need to know everything. He's innocent, and I'm going to fight until he's out of prison. Have you been to prison?
Only to visit my father.
Oh, man. What did he do?
Well, this isn't about me.
There's something deeper going on here. Why are you doing this?
My childhood was a lie.
Yeah, that's pretty rough, huh? Wouldn't you rather have just been buried alive?
I don't think so.
I think so.
But this is where you and I differ.
Okay.
In every other way, we're on exactly the same page.
Yeah, we look the same. I'm sorry I got into you. I'm just very stressed right now.
It's okay.
Because I miss my baby. I miss Cactus Tony so much.
Oh, honey, I'm so sorry. Oh, come here.
Oh, thank you. You know, Tony never hugs me, but that's okay. We made that a deal. We wrote out a big contract back in 1982.
Well, we're going to work on getting him exonerated if he is, in fact, innocent.
He is innocent!
Cactus Irene, is there anyone in Cactus Tony's life who might have reason to frame him?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Lots of people. Oh, man, there's this one guy who dresses as a Statue of Liberty and twirls a sign for, like, insurance. He and Cactus Tony have had some rows, if you will. Let's see, who else? Oh, man. This dude who owns a convenience store that we tried to do a snatch and grab, and then Cactus Tony, his pants fell down and he fell over.
Is there any message you want to give to Cactus Tony?
Yes. Yes, I would love to. Could you please tell Cactus Tony that I love him and miss him so much? And that we're going to get through this together, just like we got through that big forest fire we started together. Tony started it because he thought if I were to put it out, I would be a hero. Turned out to be one of the worst fires in the history of Colorado, summer of 2002. But we're going to get through this and tell him that I'll be there every day. I'm going to be at court every day, unless I happen to have to be at court, which happens kind of often. But I'm going to be here for him. And I love him so much. And give him a kiss. Give him a kiss for me. Like, tongue.
I'm not going to do that.
You have to.
Okay.
Please, for me.
Okay,
and when
I'll
you
do,
you gotta squeeze his butt a little bit, because that's what he likes.
Okay, I'll do it.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks, Cactus Irene.
Where's the bathroom?
I'll walk you.
Thank you so much.
Kim Keys.
So when people ask me why I'm looking into this case and why I'm trying to figure out what really happened that night in the woods, I say I'm doing it for Don DeMillo and for Cactus Irene. And also I'm doing it because if Cactus Tony didn't commit this murder, if someone else did, well then that person is still out there and they might just do it again. on the next episode of the Long Story Podcast. I'm beginning to get the feeling that Don DeMillo isn't exactly what he appears to be.
You should audition for my next show, Alex. Are you comfortable with nudity and light imprisonment?
What?
Don DeMillo? No, the Pasadena Fairy Tale Theater has no affiliation with anyone by that name.
And we'll find out a whole lot more about the victim.
Yes, I knew Sebastian very well indeed. He was extremely active in my campaign for honorary mayor of Hollywood. He was very powerful, Sebastian. Very powerful indeed. Hail Satan! Satan! Satan!
All that when the long story continues.
I don't know what to think.
All I can think is I gotta have more. I need to know.
Yes, don't you? I mean, there's so much. It's being teased out. I'm so teased.
The beauty of these podcasts is if they're well produced, they give you both sides. Mm. And you don't know until the end whether the person is really guilty or innocent. And I think this one is so adept at that because even though there's nothing suggesting he's innocent and everything suggests he's guilty, I still can't wait to find out.
I can't wait to find out because what would be the point of making this entire thing if it just turns out that he is guilty?
I would assume most of the next episodes are presenting all kinds of evidence that he's innocent because listening to that, it sure seems like he's only guilty.
I guess so, but where's the physical evidence, you know?
I mean, look, I know that he is guilty of being a bad lawyer. Yeah. But I think even he would admit to that.
You're right. And as I often do, I will head up to the head office there, pound my fist on the desk. Okay. And more than just entertainment or culture, I'm going to argue on the case of a person's life hangs in the balance here.
Oh, yeah.
That this is important investigative journalism and that we kind of owe a duty to society to pick this podcast up so that we can either right a wrong or wrong a right.
Yeah, or wrong a wrong.
Right, which is the most likely outcome.
Probably right. All right, good. We'll get up there and make the case because I think, I think you're right. This one is literally important. Okay, but there I have some people to thank here. Amanda Lund. Why am I thanking any of these people? Carl Tart, Sean Conroy, Betsy Sodaro, Jeremy Carter, and Maria Blasucci. I love all those people. I don't know why I'm thanking them. I do know why I'm thanking Dave Wilder at wilderstylemusic.com because he composed the theme song to this podcast. But those other guys, I guess I just generally thank them for being alive. Okay, well, listen. Oh, yeah, you're back. How did it go?
Didn't go. Didn't go for it.
All right. Well, you know, at least they give you a fast answer. You know, you don't have to sit around waiting for a long time.
Yeah, in fact, this one, because Ackerman has one of those glass-walled offices, and I was walking towards it, and he just put up his hand and wagged his finger and, like, gave me the motion to turn around, and then he did that kind of, like, brushed me off kind of thing.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. So. Very imperious.
Yeah.
Well, do you know what next week is?
Oh, boy.
It is the last episode of season 2 of this podcast.
And it is a barn burner.
Man, oh, man. Yeah. No kidding. Yep. When you tune into this podcast next week, you will hear The Travel Bug live with August Lindt live. And that's a big deal.
Yeah.
All right. So until then, do whatever it is that you do from Friday to Thursday.
And I imagine you just go into some kind of sleep hibernation or stasis waiting for the next episode of this podcast. I would.
That's what I would recommend. Yeah. So do that. And we will talk to you then. Thank you.
Bye.
This has been an Earwolf production, executive produced by Scott Ackerman, Chris Bannon, and Colin Anderson. For more information and content, visit earwolf.com.
This holiday season, Earwolf wants to spread some cheer. Cheerwolf, if you will.
We've got special episodes all over the network,
just for you.
Andrew T. and Tawny Newsom talk to Kulap Vilev, I can't pronounce this, about holiday racism on Yo, Is This Racist? That sounds fun.
Unspooled takes a deep dive into AFI's favorite Christmas movie, It's a Wonderful Life.
Off Book has not one, not two, not four, but three holiday-themed musicals for you to indulge in?
Surprise! All the special holiday episodes of With Special Guests are out from behind the paywall as a gift to you.
You can also check out a very special Improv for Humans episode, Best of the Bible.
On Are You Talking R.E.M. Re-Me, the Scots talk about every R.E.M. holiday single released and nothing else.
Sean and Hayes Hit the Slopes with Adam Pally on a very festive episode of Hollywood Handbook.
Beautiful Anonymous, Chris Gethard is taking calls for New Year's resolutions.
Tune in on Earwolf's Facebook page December 21st at 2 p.m. Eastern.
Marissa and Listler get a special listener call-in with a heartfelt proposal on Womp It Up.
Followed by the Christmas Womptacular, released from behind the paywall. And if that's not enough, check out even more special holiday apps from How Did This Get Made, Getting Curious, Who Charted, Threedom, of course, Comedy Bang Bang. Happy holidays, happy listening, and a merry Cheerwolf to all.
So much stuff, so much cheer. Cheerwolf.